This is Friday, January 18, 2013. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's Continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus. We are privileged to have with us today Byron Prescott. Welcome, Byron.
Nice to be here.
Well, nice you could come and interview. May I ask when you were born?
August 22nd, 1944.
And where were you born?
Newton, Massachusetts.
And what part of Newton?
Newton Upper Falls.
And where do you currently live?
I live here in Natick.
Your marital status?
Married for 42 years.
Do you have children?
I do. I have two adult daughters. Heather and her husband live out in Millbury. Mm-hmm. And my younger daughter, Corey, and her husband live in Northern Virginia.
Do you have grandchildren?
I do. I have 7.5-month-old twins, a little boy and a little girl.
Congratulations.
My oldest daughter had gave birth mm-hmm. to just this past May. Mm-hmm.
Tell us a bit about Newton Upper Falls growing up.
Oh, it was a nice little town. Mm-hmm. It was much quieter mm-hmm. in those days, growing up in the late 40s and during the 50s. And we used to play outside a lot. We didn't have video games or all of the electronic gizmos that are out there today that mm-hmm. A lot of the young people are into. And so we'd go out with a ball or a bat, and you know, and there was a ball field up the street behind the school, and you know, we'd go up there and we'd have a pickup game. Or we'd get on our bicycles and we'd ride down to Crystal Lake, which is about 4 miles away, and spend the day down there mm-hmm. and get back in time for dinner. And it was a simpler time of life.
Okay. Tell me a bit about your parents.
My dad worked for General Motors. And he retired from General Motors and He and my mother were together, I think, for almost 60 years mm-hmm. when he passed away. Mm-hmm. Mom is still alive, but she's mm-hmm. she's in her 90s, and she's in a nursing home in Newton. Actually, it's about four doors up the street from where she lived for...
No fooling.
For 68 mm-hmm. years. But she has arthritis quite badly, which makes it difficult mm-hmm. For mobility and... Otherwise, she's just as alert as you and I, and knows what medications she's taking, and knows what's going on, and mm-hmm. knows who all the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren are, and we visit two or three times a week.
Good for you. Where and when did you enter the military?
I entered November 6th, 1963. I went to the recruiting office, which was over on, at the time, was on Moody Street in Waltham. And I had gone over there during the summer and talked to the recruiter, and he said that, you know, I would be going in November, and I said, that's fine. And I had to take a physical mm-hmm. at the old Boston Army base. And at that particular time, I was pretty thin. I wasn't didn't have the extra weight that I'm carrying today, mm-hmm. and I went in for my physical, and the doctor that examined me said to me, "You're 1 pound underweight." So this was on a Friday. He said, "I want you to go home for a week." He says, "And you know, bulk up and put a couple pounds on, and come back next week." I spoke to the recruiter, and he says, just eat a bunch of bananas over the weekend, he says, and come back on Monday. And I figured there was at least 20 doctors there. I said, what are the chances I'll get the same guy again? He happened to be a full bird colonel, too. And so I came back on Monday, and of course, obviously, I did get the same doctor. And he says, I thought I told you to wait a week. As it turned out, I put on half a pound. But they signed me anyway, and mm-hmm. signed me off, and I went off to boot camp.
Okay. Why did you join at that time?
I just finished high school, mm-hmm. and I wasn't going to college at that particular time. And both I had two older brothers, had both served in the military. My brother Ernie was in the Army Reserve at that time. And my brother Arthur had already been in and out of the Air Force. And I spoke with both of them, and I decided to go into the Air Force. And I took the exams that they gave me and passed everything. And so in November of 63, I flew down to Lackland Air Force Base, Texas, down in San Antonio, Texas, for boot camp.
Texas, November 1963. Whoa.
About 2 weeks later, President Kennedy was assassinated. And I thought to myself, oh my, what have I gotten myself into now? Because the first rumor that was going around was he was shot by a Russian. And I said, wow, I said, this could, you know, just spiral out of control. But as it turned out, and as we all know, it was Lee Harvey Oswald, and who was arrested, and subsequently he was shot by
Jack Ruby.
Jack Ruby, thank you very much. I guess Mr. Ruby had an outdated press pass that he used to get through the police lines, and then a short time later, Jack Ruby passed away due to illness. So,
wow. Well, aside from that,
pretty hectic times.
Tell us a little more about BASIC in Lackland.
I was there for 5 weeks, and the weather was hot, even in November. I believe it was still in the 80s, and it was a lot of physical training. We ran just about everywhere, and you know, plus we had a lot of time at this big field. Running around the field constantly and getting into shape physically, and we had to learn military rules and regulations, and what the different ranks were, and how to address the sergeants that were conducting the training, and how to address the officers, and it was a learning experience.
Now, earlier you said that you had a brother in the Army Reserve and a brother in the Air Force. What made you go into the Air Force instead of the Army?
When I asked my brother Art what he thought about the Air Force, as opposed to my brother Ernie, what he had thought about the Army, Arthur was slightly more positive. So it was probably 60-40 at that point, and I chose the Air Force.
Okay.
And I reminded my, I told my, of course, my brother Arthur has since passed away, but my brother Ernie lives out in Colorado Springs, and I was just telling him a few months ago, I said, you know, that a few weeks before I was getting ready to go away to boot camp, I was making a cup of coffee at our home in Newton. And I was getting ready to get some cream and sugar, and they said, oh no, they don't have cream and sugar in the military. You're gonna have to get used to drinking it black. I said, really? And both of them looked at me like, oh yeah, really? So I said, okay. So I put the cream and sugar away, and I started drinking my coffee black, and I drink it black to this day. And of course, my brother denied, you know, that he ever participated in that hoax, but there was a lot of jokes played on each other.
All righty. So back in Texas, you finished your 5 weeks of basic training?
I did. And they sent us off to, well, in my group with myself, we went to Keesler Air Force Base in Biloxi, Mississippi.
And could you spell that, please?
Keesler is K-E-E-S-L-E-R.
Okay. Thank
you. And Biloxi is B-I-L-O-X-I. And we took a train, put us on a train, and those of us, they had electronic schools there, and they had radio communications, and I trained to be a radio operator.
Was this your first time away from Massachusetts overall?
Outside of trips up to New Hampshire, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're in a part of the United States which was, shall we say, in a very interesting point in history. Did you see any action outside the Air Force Base? Did you ever meet the locals?
Yes, I did, and it was not positive.
Uh-huh.
I got mugged.
Really?
Oh, yeah. And a lot of the locals down there didn't like the young airmen, especially, you know, the Northerners.
Mm-hmm.
And so there were scuffles.
And did you see any civil rights demonstrations down there?
I didn't see any civil rights demonstrations. Mm-hmm. This was, I went there, it was December of 63, and I was there mm-hmm. until through May of 64.
Uh-huh.
And, but the Jim Crow laws were very much in effect mm-hmm. down there. I had friends that went into to town, and it was they were told that the sheriff stopped them right on the sidewalk and said the blacks had to walk on this side of the street and the whites had to walk on the other side of the street.
Wow.
So I was amazed because you know we didn't have anything like that up here.
Mm-hmm.
And I still don't understand it, but it was there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, tell us what happened next.
I finished radio school, and I was given orders to go to Eglin Air Force Base in Florida for my first duty assignment.
Mm-hmm.
And I went home on leave for 30 days. And then I flew down to Eglin and reported in. And it was nice because one of my friends from radio school had already gotten there before me, mm-hmm. and he met me when I got off the bus.
Well, that's good.
And
yeah.
And so that was in the summer of 64, and actually his name was Eugene Spudich, and I spoke to him about a week ago.
All right.
Lives in Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
And we talk about once a year.
Oh, great.
We keep in touch.
Okay, so your first duty station, what was your rank?
Airman Third Class.
Okay.
That would be an E2. In today's military. Uh-huh. I think they did away with the Airman Third Class designation. They simply call them airmen.
Okay.
Today.
And what were your duties?
I was a radio operator, that mm-hmm. I had completed the radio operator training. And they sent me to work out in the control center,
mm-hmm.
Where they were running ongoing missions for training. And they would fly, sometimes they'd fly paratroopers out over open fields. Eglin is a huge complex. They have, mm-hmm. I think, 9 different fields. And so the paratroopers might be training one day. Another day, I was involved in training where they had low-flying aircraft practicing what they called LAPES, L-A-P-E-S. It stood for low-altitude parachute extraction. And I didn't think much of it at the time, but later on in Vietnam, there's no question it helped save my life.
Really?
We were, and this jumping forward a bit,
mm-hmm.
The base I was at was surrounded. We were under siege, and we were running out of supplies, and that's how they delivered our supplies. Fortunately, their aim wasn't too good. So when they dropped all these supplies, we ran out of our base to get some supplies, and the enemy ran out and got some supplies, and the people in town got some supplies, and the shooting stopped while everybody was gathering up whatever they could get their hands on.
Mm-hmm.
We got most of what we were supposed to get.
Oh, that's good.
So, but they dropped food, they dropped mm-hmm. fuel,
mm.
They dropped ammunition to us. So we were taken care of.
Okay, let's reel it back to Florida now.
Yeah.
So how long were you stationed in Florida?
I was there about a year.
Okay.
And after about a year, I received orders to go to Clark Air Base in the Philippines. It was supposed to be for an 18-month tour of duty at in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got there, I was assigned to the 608th Tactical Control Squadron, which they had, had just put together. And we were awaiting supplies and equipment to work as a communications squadron. But it seemed like every time they had equipment coming to us, it would get sent to Vietnam instead.
Mm-hmm.
And this would be in, this was in summer of 65. So after 8 months, they decided, the Air Force decided just to disband the 608th Tactical Control Squadron. So they decided they would keep a third of us there in the Philippines, a third of us would go back to bases in the United States, and a third would go to other bases throughout the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I wound up being sent back after 8 months to Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma. It was in Oklahoma City, on the outskirts of Oklahoma City.
Mm-hmm.
It was a good sized base. And again, I was in the third Mobile Communications Squadron at that time. We called it the third MOB. And they had a number of mobile communications squadrons throughout the Air Force. When I was part of the 608th in the Philippines, that was attached to the first mobile communications group. And so when I was in Tinker, I was attached to the third mobile communications group, third mobile communications squadron.
Let's jump back to the Philippines for a second. This was your first trip overseas.
Oh, yes.
And you're halfway around the world. What do you think about the Philippines?
Oh, I was. It was exciting.
Mm-hmm.
It was a tropical, or environment.
Mm-hmm.
I remember training, taking jungle training, and picking bananas off the trees, and it was exciting. I just I loved it. I enjoyed it tremendously. The people over there were very outgoing. They were friendly.
Mm-hmm.
When MacArthur and U.S. troops fought for the Filipinos during World War II, they earned us a lot of respect, and especially the older Filipinos that remembered World War II, they treated us very well. And I enjoyed it tremendously.
Mm-hmm. So now you're back in Oklahoma. Are you still an E-2?
I was an E-3 at that point, the Airman's Second Class.
Okay.
And we worked, again, as a communications squadron, mobile. We would set up our equipment on a regular basis. We'd set up tents, and they would time us. Everything had to be done quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd get our equipment set up, our teletype equipment, our radio equipment, and our generators, our lighting, and everything had to be in place. And then they'd say, okay, take it down, pack it up. And from time to time, we'd go out in the field for 3 or 4 days for practice exercises, either in Oklahoma or occasionally we'd drive down into North Texas by military convoy. We'd load everything up onto these 2.5 and 5-ton trucks and drive on down to some vacant abandoned airfield, and we'd use it. And again, everything had to be set up, and, communicate with other units doing the same thing in different parts of the country.
Mm-hmm.
And developed our skills. And so I was there for about a year.
Mm-hmm.
But 6 months of that time, I spent deployed to Panama.
Really?
It wasn't quite 6 months. It was one day shy of a 6 month assignment. It was 179 days. If they sent you for 180 days, that would be a permanent reassignment. So the longest they could send you for what they call temporary duty, or TDY, mm-hmm. would be 179 days. And it was quite common for them to fill positions with temporary airmen. So they sent me to Panama for 179 mm-hmm. days at Albrook Air Force Base in the Panama Canal Zone. And somewhat the environment was similar to the Philippines. There was a lot of jungle, it was tropical. Mm-hmm. I didn't pick any bananas off the trees, but I did pick mangoes off the trees. And they had the mango trees growing right on the base. And oh, they were so good. You know, I tend to think about the good meals I had at these different places. And it was just, I enjoyed the time that I was down there.
Okay. So down to Panama, back to Oklahoma. Tell us what happened next.
Back to Oklahoma. I arrived back on Thanksgiving Day in, mm-hmm. In 1966. And reported back in. And it was about a month later, in December, I was given orders that I would be going to Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
But I was going to be going to, they wanted me to attend the Air Force Survival School first. And that would be out in near Tacoma, Washington. And it was actually in the mountains. They had a camp just above Tacoma.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got my orders, it said that I was supposed to go to Vietnam in May of 1967. So I said, well, gee, I'm due to get discharged in November of 67. So I said, I better take these down to the orderly room and inquire about this. So I went down and I spoke to the clerk and I said, oh, do I just go for 6 months? I'm supposed to get discharged. He says, no. He says, obviously we made a mistake. He says, we'll just tear these up and throw them away and you don't have to go. I said, well, supposing I wanted to go.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked at my orders and he said, well, you'd have to extend your enlistment for 7 months. I said, well, type it up. And about 5 minutes later, I signed off.
Mm-hmm.
And so my enlistment was going to be for 4 years and 7 months. And that's what I did. So I was pretty gung-ho back in at that time. And,
mm-hmm.
and I wanted to do my share. I wanted to participate. And so I went to, I think it was in April, I had to go to the survival school. And then after I finished survival school, then I went to Vietnam in May mm-hmm. of 67.
Tell us a little bit about the survival school.
It was primarily for air crews. There were pilots, navigators, a lot of commissioned officers, and at that time I was just an airman second class.
Mm-hmm.
And but they trained us what to expect should we be taken captive, and they trained us how to live off the land if we had to found ourselves in that mm-hmm. position where we were cut off, or if we had to escape and evade enemy soldiers. And they taught us some hand-to-hand combat techniques. And they took us up into the mountains and showed us how to set up a smokehouse if we had some if we were able to kill an animal We didn't have to kill any animals. They they just gave us, I think it was a 7-pound roast beef to take. Well, it wasn't roasted. It was just a 7-pound. But what we did was we used a parachute, and we built a our own smoker. And we took the 7 pounds of beef, and we thin sliced it into strips, and we made beef jerky using the smokehouse. It was a pretty
handy thing to have.
Yes, it was. So every one of us got a good size pouch of beef jerky to take with us during the remainder of our training up in the mountains. We were up in the mountains for 5 days. And we didn't get a lot to eat, so that beef jerky was pretty darn good.
Mm.
And some of the other stuff they gave us was, they called it pemmican.
Yeah.
And it would, quite frankly, tasted awful. But it was high in protein.
Right.
And and finally, after 5 days of training up in the mountains, we came back down to camp, and then we had to go through the POW training. And that was difficult. We had a long obstacle course that we had to go through, and at the end of the obstacle course, we were all captured, and they locked us up in boxes for I wouldn't even call it a cell. They were really small cells, and we were kept in there for about 24 hours. No windows, no ventilation. They just gave us a bucket to use for to relieve ourselves. And then after that, we were taken out and we were interrogated. And everybody was told in advance, leave your wallets at home. Do not bring anything that has any personal information on it that these people can use against you. And so I was interrogated, and I had, done as I was told. And we were then put into a larger camp. And we were in the camp, I think, for about 3 days. And we were subjected to a variety of types of harassment by the so-called aggressors. And at the end of the training period, I think I went home for 30 days leave, and then I flew to Vietnam.
And you said that was in May of 67?
May of 67.
Okay.
May 15th.
May 15th. So, where did you land in Vietnam?
Landed in Saigon. And I remember walking down the street shortly after at Tan Son Nhut Air Base. And I think I hadn't been there half an hour, and as I was walking down the street at the base, I heard somebody yell, "Hey, Byron!" And it was one of the fellows that I'd gone through radio school with 3.5 years earlier.
Wow.
And his name was Norman. Norman Topp from, I think he was from Los Angeles. No, no, and we shook hands and we caught up, talked for a little bit. You know, it was good to see him. And then I had to catch another flight leaving Saigon. That took me down to Can Tho, which was a city down in the Mekong Delta, to Binh Tuy Air Base. That's B-I-N-H-T-H-U-Y. And that was where I was going to be assigned. And when I got there, they said, "Well, you're not going to be here at the base. You're going to be loaned out to the Army for a year. And you're going to be working for the Army. And you're going to be the liaison communications person." And I was assigned to a MACV team. And these MACV teams were Military Assistance Command Vietnam is what it stood for. You know, they were advisory teams. And they provided advice, and they worked with the South Vietnamese Army. And so I worked on three different teams while I was there during the year. The first one I was sent to was in Vinh Long, again, down in the Mekong Delta. And I was there from May until it was October. And most of the time it was quiet. We finally did get attacked. At one point, we were living in a small hotel that the Army had taken over mm-hmm. on the outskirts of town. And when I went to work, they had a Jeep assigned to myself and the other radio operator, and we would just alternate using the Jeep to go back and forth because the operations center was downtown, mm-hmm. a couple miles away. So we would drive back and forth to the operations center, and that's where our radio station was. And we would call in. Our job was to call in airstrikes, mm-hmm. and whenever one of our teams in the area or our people came under fire, if they needed tactical air support, they would call us. Mm-hmm. And I would be called on one radio, then I had another radio mm-hmm. That I could call Saigon to get tactical air support. And this was very important. Mm-hmm. We had to get support for these men out in the field right away. Mm-hmm. These were life and death situations. And so I spent, it was about the middle of October. And again, we were only involved, in one firefight there where the hotel was attacked. Mm-hmm. They opened fire on us from across the street, another building. But we returned fire, and then helicopters circled overhead and lit up the area and put a lot of fire down on top of the enemy. The enemy had to retreat. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, excuse me, okay. The base was under attack. That was about 2 or 3 kilometers up the street. And come to find out that a lot of the friendly Vietnamese that worked at the base were actually Viet Cong soldiers.
Oh, wow.
And so they, when they policed up the dead and wounded after the battle, quite a few of these fellas worked on the base mm-hmm. and had given their officers detailed sketches and diagrams of the base so that the mortar crews were able to fire for effect. Mm-hmm. And so that took place. And then it was in October, I left mm-hmm. Vinh Long and I got reassigned to SADC. That was about 15 kilometers up the road, mm-hmm. Due west. Mm-hmm. It was closer to the Cambodian border.
Okay.
So I went to SADC, and it was on a little piece of land jutting out into the Mekong River, and they had barbed wire in the shallow part of the water, so they couldn't infiltrate. Mm-hmm. And it was mm-hmm. that was the quietest of the three bases that I was at. Uh-huh. And I was there until December. Our commanding officer was a Lieutenant Colonel Andrew Matthias. Mm-hmm. Nice man. I figured he must have been incredibly old at the time because he had white hair.
Oh dear.
And because I was 23 at the time. Mm-hmm. And I think he was in his 40s. But I just figured, yeah. Incredibly mm-hmm. old. And we lost him.
Oh.
He was killed in a rocket attack. He had gone to a meeting for commanders down at Ventura Air Base. And his deputy commander, Major Miller, said, "Oh, Colonel, would you like me to go to this meeting?" He says, and he said, "No, no, Roger." He says, "You've been to the last couple of meetings." He says, "I'll go to this one." Mm-hmm. And he was killed in a rocket attack.
Wow.
Nice man.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2 days after Christmas, mm-hmm. I was reassigned again. And they needed a radio operator in a little place called Kaolan, C-A-O-L-A-N-H. And that was a little bit north of where I had been.
Mm-hmm.
And so they took me up there by helicopter. And they had a small airstrip outside of town that they called Kaolan International Airport. And they couldn't land anything much bigger than a Cessna there, but mm-hmm. they're this small airport. But and I think they had signs up saying Los Angeles was 10,197 miles, and New York was mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. something similar. And once a month, we had to go out to the airstrip to get paid while I was there. And the our first sergeant would fly in with mm-hmm. one of the pilots, and he'd get off the airplane, and the few of us, there was only a handful of us in the Air Force on this camp, mm-hmm. The rest of it was Army. And he would give us our paychecks, and we'd immediately sign the paycheck, mm-hmm. hand it back to him, and he would cash it for us. And, you know, mm-hmm. we'd be, of course, we weren't allowed to have American cash.
Mm-hmm.
They paid us in what they call scrip.
Right.
Or military pay certificates. They used to mm-hmm. refer to them as MPCs. And quite frankly, it looked like monopoly money.
Mm-hmm.
And, but that's what we had, you know, and it was good if we spent it on the base or local economy, the local business people mm-hmm. accepted it. If I went to town to get my laundry done, I would pay the laundry lady, and I'd pick up my shirts would all be starched and cleaned, and
mm-hmm.
if I wanted to buy something to eat, I think I bought a pair of sandals,
mm-hmm.
and that was fun buying the sandals. Actually, they weren't sandals so much; they were flip flops.
Okay.
I wanted to buy a pair of flip flops, and when I was in Sadek, and I went to the PX on base, and they said, "We don't have any, but there's a lady downtown who's got a big, huge box full of them, and she's selling them on such and such a street corner." And they said, you have to go down and deal with her. So I said, okay. So I went to town, and I'd learned to speak enough Vietnamese that I could carry on a conversation at that point. And so I said to her, "How much, Ban Yu?" And then there were three other ladies sitting there with her, the four of them. And she told me that she wanted 100 piastres. And of course, you're expected to haggle. And I said, "Oh my goodness," I said, "I couldn't possibly afford that much money. We're talking about a dollar." And I said, "I've got a sick family at home." I said, "I've got sick parents." I said, "I've got sick children." I said, "I've got to send most of my money home." And I'm all the time I'm talking in Vietnamese, and I surprised myself. I remembered that much. And I had these four old ladies in stitches, and I bought those flip-flops for 10 cents.
Oh, wow.
And that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
But so that's how they paid us. They paid mm-hmm. us in the scrip. So when I first got to Kaolan,
mm-hmm.
I was already an experienced radio operator. I knew how to call in the airstrikes. The only thing I needed to learn at this new base was the specifics about the layout of the base
mm-hmm.
and who my contacts were. And so the radio operator that was getting ready to leave, he was due to leave in about a week. His name was Fred. And he said, "Okay, kid, I'm going to tell you all about this job and blah, blah, blah." You know, and he was going to break me in and, you know, give me all the information. I said, well, Fred, I said, not to, you know, be cocky or anything, but I've already been in the country for 7 months, and I'm very familiar with the job. I said, but, you know, there was certain information that I needed, and so he gave, you know, I got information on, which turned out to be, you know, really good information on contacts.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and you know, I learned the layout of the base and how to get, you know, what I could do on and off base. As it turned out, we very seldom went off base at this little spot. It wasn't as safe,
mm-hmm,
as the two previous bases. I went off to get my laundry done, and I would drop it off and with the lady in town, and I'd leave, and I'd go back and pick it up a couple of days later. Other than that, I didn't go to town.
Mm-hmm.
There was really nothing to go to town for. And I asked the lieutenant, I said, you know, Fred's still going to be here for several more days. I said, is there any chance that I could go visit my friend David? Dave DeLore grew up next door to me in Newton.
Mm-hmm.
He was in the Army, and he was a supply man at Vung Tau, Army-Navy base.
Right.
Uh-huh. It was on the South China Sea, and it was used as a recreation center for the men that were in country. They had beautiful white sand beaches, and it was safe to go into town, and they had bars, they had restaurants, and they had a nice hotel for the men to stay at. So I went to the lieutenant and I said, you know, I'd like to be able to go down and visit, you know, my friend for a couple of days. He says, I don't have time to cut orders for you on such short notice. He said, but if your friend can put you up, he said, I'll allow you to go. You just, mm-hmm, have to be back, you know, before Fred leaves.
Right.
And so I only went and stayed two nights.
Mm-hmm.
And it was kind of a unique experience because and a lot of people don't know this, but I went down to the beach with David, and there was one little strand of barbed wire running down the middle of the beach. And I said, David, I said, what's with the strand of barbed wire? He says, Byron, he says, we're not the only ones taking our rest and relaxation here. He said, both sides come here. He says, the enemy comes here.
Mm-hmm.
He says, they stay on one side of the barbed wire, and we stay on the other side, and there's no fighting allowed in town. And it was an unwritten rule, but everybody knew it,
mm-hmm,
and there was never any violations in town. They had their little restaurants that they went to, and we had ours, and we weren't even allowed to carry weapons in town. So when I arrived, he says, you know, he said to me, Byron, he says, what are you doing with those weapons? I had an M16 rifle, I had a 38 revolver, and I think I had a couple of hand grenades in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, I said, there's a war going on out there. He says, not here, there isn't. He says, you'll have to turn those guns into the first sergeant and you can pick them up when you leave. I think I turned over the rifle and the pistol I just hit underneath my shirt. I was just not about to turn over.
Mm-hmm.
And as it was totally quiet. It was benign. It,
mm-hmm,
was, I had a pleasant 2 days. I got a couple of nice meals.
Mm-hmm.
I got to go to the beach. It was good.
Wow.
And David, you know, he got one of the nicest assignments. He spent his entire year there, just working in supply at this little resort on the South China Sea.
Lucky man.
Yeah. So then I flew back. I got a ride back to my base.
Mm-hmm.
And the month of January was pretty quiet. But on the 30th, I went to bed at the stroke of midnight, I was sound asleep in my bunk. I heard gunfire right outside my door. And I jumped up and I used to keep my pants would be set on top of my boots, mm-hmm. so I could just jump into my boots and pull my pants up. And I was, in a matter of seconds, I was fully dressed. I had my flak jacket, my helmet, I grabbed my weapon, and I ran outside. And the local Vietnamese guards at our base were firing their rifles into the air. It was the beginning of Tet,
okay.
which was the biggest holiday that they had in Vietnam. It's like Christmas, New Year's, and Easter all rolled into one. It's by far their biggest holiday. And I was told, there's a truce between the North Vietnamese and the American troops for this holiday. Well, we all know from history that the truce was broken within a matter of an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, oh, okay, so it's just these fellows shooting off their rifles. And so I went back I went back to my bunk, went back to sleep. And then the first mortar shell came in around 2 a.m. And as it turned out, we were surrounded. And they kept up these mortar attacks 22 days, and we were attacked with rockets and mortars and small arms fire. And night after night, we'd return fire. I was frequently in a relay, passing mortar shells up to the men that were firing the mortars, the ground crews, guys were pretty good at firing these guns. Some of them were. They had a small 86 millimeter mortar, which was handheld, and it was mounted on top of some sandbags. And the sergeant that was firing it was able to aim it, and he'd been doing this for a long time. He was a career NCO.
Mm-hmm.
And he would get get them to fire in the direction he wanted. But the largest of the mortars was a 4.2 millimeter mortar. It was a much bigger barrel, mm-hmm. and that had that was on the top of a that was stationary on top of a large steel plate. And they they would have to use tools to reset the position. To change the angle of the barrel so that they could direct their fire against the enemy. And every night for the 22 nights, we had what they called an AC-47 Dragon ship would be overhead firing down at the enemy, and normally that would stay on. Over us for 4 hours and 25 minutes each night until they ran low on fuel. That was all they could stay, was 4 hours and 25 minutes. But they would fire continuously, almost, with a 30 millimeter cannon fire.
Mm-hmm.
They'd fly in a left-hand pattern because the guns were mounted on the left-hand side of their ship. Because it was an AC-47 Dragon ship, up north, they called it Puff the Magic Dragon. Down south on the Mekong Delta, we called it Spooky.
Mm-hmm.
And but it was very, very impressive to watch and to know that, there was only less than 300 of us on this base. And we were surrounded by an estimated force of approximately 12,000.
Wow.
And without this enormous firepower, we would have certainly been overrun. But they kept the enemy at bay for
mm-hmm.
for 22 nights. And finally, on the 22nd day, we the U.S. 9th Infantry, along with the Vietnamese 9th Infantry, broke through from the south and engaged the enemy in a large-scale battle just south of town, just south of the base.
in a wooded area that was between the base and the airfield. And I was on the radio with these fellas, and they were going through a really, really difficult time. Mm-hmm. And I got a call on the radio asking for, well, they weren't just asking for assistance, they were begging for assistance. They said, "For God's sakes, help us, they're killing us."
Mm-hmm.
And excuse me.
Quite all right.
So I called up to Saigon, and I requested tactical air support through the Air Force, and they said, "Sorry, got nothing for you. Everybody's under fire." This was the Tet Offensive. So I said, "Okay." So this goes back to all those numbers I collected earlier when I first got there. So I called the Army. I said, "I need gunships." I said, "I've got troops in heavy contact, and I need support." And they said, "Sorry, kid, got nothing for you."
Mm-hmm.
So I went and I called the Navy. Down at they were in Canto. They had a base down there, and they said, "You got it." They said, "We'll send you a flight of Navy Sea Wolves." And I think it was a flight of 5 helicopters, gunships, and they came, and they took a lot of enemy fire, and they got holes shot in their ships, and some men got wounded, but they were able to drive the enemy back, and our people were able to withdraw wounded soldiers, and they put themselves into a more advantageous position, and they were eventually able to push the enemy out of the area. And these guys absolutely saved the day. They, after being shot up quite a bit, the commander ordered the flight to go back to base.
Mm-hmm.
And this one officer said, "I'm not leaving." He said, "I've still got some ammunition left, and these men still need me." So he circled 2 more times and firing the remainder of his ammunition, even though his ship was taking fire. And then he thought, "Well, I'll make one more pass, and they'll still duck because they won't know I'm out of ammunition."
Mm-hmm.
So he buzzed them again, and just like he figured, they all ducked. And so our guys were able to reposition themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And then he did it one more time. Of course, they didn't fall for it the second time, and he took a lot of fire, and some people got wounded, and he was able to take his ship and go back to base. Well, the Navy wanted to court-martial him for disobeying orders, and the Army wanted to give this guy Medal of Honor. So I don't know what they settled on. It was something in between. Probably, I don't know if he got a Bronze Star or what, but they didn't court-martial him, and...
Mm-hmm.
And he was definitely the star of the day.
Oh, God love him.
And then at about that time, a lot of our guys too were running out of ammunition. So I asked them. I said, "What kind of ammunition do you need?" He said, "Well, they needed M16 ammunition." So I said, "Okay." I said, "I'll bring it out to you." And because I'd already gotten them the tactical air support that they needed at that point. So I went over to supply, and I loaded up my Jeep, I think, with 4 cases of ammunition. And I told him on the radio where to meet me. And I drove down the road, and these 2 fellas came running out of the woods, and each took 2 cases of ammunition. They ran back into the woods, but there was a lot of gunfire going on around, so I just drove a little bit further on. Rather than turn around and go back to the base, I went to the airstrip. And I took up a defensive position at the airstrip for the next couple of hours.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, the fighting was becoming more and more distant, and things were getting quiet. So at that point, I jumped in my Jeep and went back to the base.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a busy day.
Say the least, a whole busy 3 weeks.
Yeah, it was a busy 3 weeks.
What was going through your mind? Just survival? Were you going to see your family again?
Never even. I just was concentrating on the task at hand.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think, you know, looking back, I thought, yeah, you know, bad things can happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't dwell on it. I just tried to do what I was trained to do. And sometimes during the attacks, we'd have to go into the bunkers and, you know, while the other people, you know, would fire the guns. And you know, other times I'd be in part of the the line. And just did as I was told and, you know, used my training to make sure that those guys had all of the...
Did you think your training was adequate?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Saved your life and stuff?
Yes, it did.
Okay. So tell us what happened afterward.
Well, after the final day of fighting, the next morning it was quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was totally exhausted. I think I'd been up for 48 hours straight at that point. And went for breakfast at the little dining hall that we had there on the camp. And the commander was cooking, and the first sergeant was serving the meals.
Oh, wow.
And it was breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we had bacon and eggs, coffee.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they had some lemonade. Because during the siege, you know, most of our stuff was gone.
Right.
So they didn't have a lot at that point. Mm-hmm. But afterwards, you know, they were able to resupply.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the end of February. And then I think we had sporadic mortar attacks from then until May. And I think it was around the 9th of May, somebody came up to me and said, "Here's your orders, Byron. You know, you're shipping out." And I'm thinking, wow, 6 days early. Excellent.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember too much about, it was just a blur at that point. But I had to get a ride up to Saigon.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to the airstrip and, you know, I made arrangements to get on a helicopter and somebody gave me a flight up to Saigon. I checked in with base operations up there, and they said, "Yeah, you'll be flying out on the next day on a big airliner, and you'll be going to Travis Air Force Base in California, and you'll be discharged." So I packed up everything I could and took my duffel bag, and I flew. I think I turned in at a turn in my my rifle. I'd already had it. I turned in the handgun already.
Mm-hmm.
I was never actually authorized to have the 38.
Mm-hmm.
And when I had been at Vin Long earlier in the season, the previous summer, I mentioned to, you know, my the pilot that I worked for that it was my birthday, and it was August. And he said, "Oh, what do you want for your birthday?" I says, "Can you get me a 38? He says, "Sure, no problem." He was a major.
Okay.
You know, so as I recall at the time, we flew down to Bintoui Air Base, and we went over to supply, and there was a tech sergeant there. And the major said, "Sergeant," he said, "I'd like to draw two 38 revolvers." And the major said, the supply sergeant, he was kind of a gruff looking guy. He looked at the major, he says, "Sir," he says, "this man is not authorized to have a 38. He said, "I can't give you one for him." He turned around and he says to me, "Byron, here's the keys to the Jeep." Threw me the keys. He says, "Come back in an hour." I came back an hour later and he had the guns. And he says, "This one's for you," he says, "and this one's for your roommate." The other radio operator that I worked with.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time. So for months afterwards, I was getting letters saying, "You're not authorized to have those weapons. Turn them in." But I waited until about 2 weeks before it was time to go home.
Mm-hmm.
And I turned them in at that point.
Okay.
And then I turned in my rifle, of course, you know, when I shipped out that day, too. And I remember getting on the airplane, and one of the fellas that I had been stationed with during the siege of Kowloon was there with me. And he had been out in the field for 2 or 3 days, and he came back in, and he was carrying the radio on his back.
Mm-hmm.
And when he took the radio off, the antenna had been shot off just over his shoulder, and there was a bullet in the battery pack. And, of course, he proceeded to get quite drunk.
Oh, boy.
You know, kind of a rough day out, mm-hmm. out in the field. And he was an Army staff sergeant. He was a career man. And so while he was sitting there having his drinking that night, one of the officers came up to him and said to him, "We're shipping you home tomorrow on emergency leave. Your mother is, your father had passed away."
Oh.
And so he was, turned out he was going to be on the same plane that I was. So we sat together, you know, we flew back. And just before we took off, a military policeman got on and said, "This is a military charter flight. There is no drinking on board this aircraft. Anybody caught drinking or drunk will be taken off when we refuel in Okinawa, and mm-hmm. they'll be thrown in the brig."
Mm-hmm.
So we took off, and my friend immediately went to sleep. And the young flight attendant, when she came down the aisle, asked if I wanted coffee. And I said, "Oh, yeah, thank you very much. I had a cup of coffee." And she said, "How about your friend?" I said, "No, he's all set." She said, "He's not drunk, is he?" And I said, "No, ma'am, he's exhausted.
Mm-hmm.
Leave him alone." She left him alone. And so he had to go home to his family in Arizona to help his mother out.
Mm-hmm. And what about you?
And I landed at Travis Air Force Base. And it was already the middle of the afternoon. So there was a staff sergeant that told us that I was a buck sergeant myself at this point. And he said to us, "We don't have time to get all you fellas processed today." He said, "So I want you back here at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning." He said, "There's a barracks over there." He says, "Dining hall is just up the road." He said, "Get yourself a room for the night at the transit barracks."
Mm-hmm.
And it was just an open bay barracks. You know, they had all the bunks in a row.
Right.
And I went to the dining hall and got some dinner, and that night I went to sleep in my bunk, and it was about 5 a.m. Somebody drove by and tooted their horn right outside, and we had a horn that went off when we were being attacked.
Oh no.
When I was at my previous base, and so I immediately rolled out of bed and underneath the bunk, just looking for, you know, a little bit of protection, you know, in case of incoming fire. And I said, "Wait a second, this is Travis Air Force Base."
Mm-hmm.
So I was feeling kind of sheepish, and I'm looking around, and I'm trying to get back into bed without being noticed, and I saw about five other guys doing the same thing. So I didn't feel quite so bad.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next morning, I went over to the orderly room, and they gave me my discharge papers. I signed off, and they gave me a plane ticket back to Boston, which I flew on a commercial aircraft.
And, mm-hmm.
and I went home, and 24 hours later, I was walking down the street just like... It was a transition period.
Uh-huh.
You know, I used to jump at loud noises for quite a while.
And speaking of transition, now you're sort of out of the Army, at least off active duty, and You're now in the heart of anti-war.
Oh, yes.
Ah, yes.
Oh,
tell
yes.
Tell us about that.
I was put off by it. Mm-hmm. I'm typical, I think, of a lot of Vietnam vets. I was there by choice.
Mm-hmm.
I believed in what we were doing.
Mm-hmm.
Whether history shows it to be right or wrong is beside the point.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't like the celebrities that were going over, and sitting on top of North Vietnamese tanks and getting their pictures taken, and
mm-hmm.
and I still don't. I wouldn't watch any of Hanoi Jane's movies even today.
Okay.
You know, and I know it's over 40 years ago. Maybe uh-huh. I should get over it, but it's the anti-war movement, and I understand the reason mm-hmm. for it. We lost 58,000 men.
Mm-hmm. Were you ever personally harassed or by anti-war protesters?
I was not.
Okay.
No, I was not.
Mm-hmm.
I was home about a year. And I mentioned to a friend of mine that I was thinking of joining the Air National Guard. I actually tried to re-enlist only a few months after I came home.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have a job at the time. And I went and talked to the recruiter. And mm-hmm. he says, right now we've got a freeze on enlistments for prior service personnel.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I expect that'll be lifted within a couple of months. He said, I'll give you a call. So a couple of months later, he called me up. I said, unfortunately, I said, I can't come right now. I said, because I'd been in an accident and I had a broken wrist.
Ouch.
So I had a cast mm-hmm. on my wrist. And he says, okay. He says, call me when you get the cast off. A couple of months later, I called him up and I said, I got the cast off. My arm is fine. He says, well, everything's back on hold again. So, you know, wasn't to be.
Mm-hmm.
And but in the meantime, I had found out about the Air National Guard. And I went to, it was in the spring of 69. I went to the Wellesley Air National Guard base. And the recruiter there was a Mr. Hanley. He was mm-hmm. a chief warrant officer. And I said, I'm interested in joining. He says, tell you what, kid. He says, I'll take your name and your number. He says, maybe I'll call you in about a year and a half. Because of all the protesting that was going on, everybody wanted to join the National Guard because the National Guard wasn't going to Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
As it turned out, some of them actually did, but they were few and far between.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Air National Guard in Massachusetts was pretty full up. And I said, well, Mr. Hanley, I said, I've already got 4.5 years of active duty behind me, I said, and I've already spent a year in Vietnam. He says, oh, that's different. Sign here, raise your hand, you're in. So they had a spot. And as it turns out, a lot of the career men that were in that outfit had their sons and their nephews in there also.
Mm-hmm.
It was very much a good old boy network at that time, where they took care of their friends and their family. And but I got in, and I made a lot of friends there, and people that I still talk to and see occasionally. And the next thing you know, I had 30 years in. And so I retired, I think it was in spring of 94, March of 94.
When you were in the Air National Guard, did you basically stay in Massachusetts, or?
Pretty much.
Okay.
Especially at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
In the early years, we would go to do our 2 weeks of active duty.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first time we went out, I had to do 2 weeks of active duty, we went up to Niagara Falls, New York. There was a base up there that we used. And so that was a long, I think that was about a 10 or 12 hour drive going up there. be about 8 hours if you're driving within in your own car, mm-hmm. but these trucks are slow.
Right.
And so we had a convoy up there, and it took us, it was an all-day project. And, well, that was okay. Mm-hmm. Most of the time we just stayed at, either went out to Westover Air Force Base in Chicopee, and we'd set up our equipment there, mm-hmm. or we'd go down the Cape mm-hmm. to Otis. The first time I went down the Cape for an, Otis was still an active Air Force base, but then I think it was in 72, they closed it and it became a reserve base. And the that was, it was right after the elections in Massachusetts. Everybody was riding around with their bumper stickers saying, "We're the one."
Mm-hmm.
You know, the only state that hadn't voted for the
yep.
incoming president. And he said, "You're the one." And he shut down Otis Air Force Base. He shut down Westover Air Force Base. Mm-hmm. He shut down the Boston Army Base. He shut down the Boston Navy Base. And I think there was a hospital.
Yep.
Shut it all down. And so that was politics.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So what rank were you holding at the time?
Master Sergeant.
Master Sergeant. And were you still a radio operator?
No, actually I had retrained and had become a teletype operator, which I needed to do in order to get the Master Sergeant position
mm-hmm.
when it was offered to me. I think I'd been a Master Sergeant at the time I retired for about 7 years.
Uh-huh.
And so I retrained and I'd attended the NCO Academy and down at McGee Tyson Air National Guard Base. I was down in Knoxville, Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
And by that time, we had started deployments to other countries.
Mm-hmm.
I took part in exercises during the time that we were involved in Bosnia. I deployed to Aviano Air Base in northern Italy. I was close to the Adriatic,
mm-hmm.
and right on the opposite side of the Adriatic Sea was Bosnia. So we had fighters that were based in Aviano, Italy, that were mm-hmm. supporting the war effort over in Bosnia
okay.
at that time. And so I participated in that for a couple of weeks. I think it was 1980 I deployed up to Norway.
Norway, wow.
For a couple of weeks for Exercise Cool Fox.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just below the Arctic Circle. But it was we were there in midsummer. It was beautiful.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful. And it was just such a picturesque little town. And
better than midwinter, right?
Oh, yes. Yeah, it was nice. And the people were mm-hmm. were very nice. And I just enjoyed that tremendously. I got to do some fishing while I was there.
Mm-hmm.
And I had met a Norwegian couple. And they said they were going fishing, and they offered to take me along, and they made a little campfire on the side of the stream, and we had sandwiches and coffee, and the gentleman that I had met, they had extra equipment, so I was out with the waders and the uh-huh. casting, and I didn't catch anything, but it was a lot of fun.
Right. And did you travel anywhere else before your retirement?
I did. I did an exercise in Germany,
mm-hmm.
and during the time in Germany, I'd just gotten promoted to Master Sergeant, and they'd already picked me for this assignment when I was still a Tech Sergeant, and when I got over there, they said to me, "Oh, we weren't expecting a Master Sergeant. This is Technical Sergeant work. You know, Master Sergeants are our managers." They said, "Oh, we don't have much of anything for you to do." And I said, "Well, I'll come in, you know, and if you find something, you know, you can, you know, I'll work." So, but they didn't really have much. So they had their recreation center was advertising a 3-day trip over the weekend. It was like a Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
I said, "Well, do you mind if I take this Friday, Saturday, Sunday off to go to Austria and Liechtenstein?" And they said, go ahead, enjoy yourself." So,
okay.
So I went with two other fellas, and we took a bus and on this 3-day tour. And we drove through the Alps in Austria. And I remember seeing there was a big statue of Heidi, mm-hmm. who was really a fictional character.
Yeah.
But she was well known. I think it was in Switzerland. I think we went through it. We went through Austria, Switzerland, and Liechtenstein, and so they had a big statue of her alongside the road near the village where she was supposed to have lived.
Mm-hmm.
And these places were just beautiful, and you know, I got to eat the local food, and it was all mm-hmm. it was good. And mm-hmm. other times I participated, you know, in more active exercises.
Mm-hmm. So when you were not engaged in Air National Guard activities, what were you doing?
I was a firefighter for the city of Newton.
Uh-huh.
I got hired in 1972, and I worked as a firefighter for 29 years. I retired. I was a lieutenant on an engine company, and that was in 2001.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you've been married for a good long time.
42 years, and I was busy with raising, mm-hmm. helping my wife, you know, with our daughters, and I took them to skating lessons over at the skating rink here in Natick, and I think they both took dance lessons at one point, and or maybe gymnastics at another time.
Uh-huh.
I think they both played soccer, and
yeah.
I just, you know, was involved in their activities. And
mm-hmm. and when did you move to Natick again?
73.
And why Natick?
It was affordable.
Uh-huh.
And we had looked at quite a few homes in the area. At the time, we'd been renting an apartment down in Newton, close to where I mm-hmm. grew up, and we bought this little starter home out mm-hmm. here in Natick, and well, we're still in it. Added on to it, put a big addition onto it mm-hmm. as the family grew.
Right.
And but Natick is it's a nice town.
Okay.
It's got a good educational system. Mm-hmm. The schools are good. Both my daughters got good educations. They both went on to college, and they've done well.
Good. And as far as, did you join any service organizations?
I belong to veterans organizations. Mm-hmm. I belong to the Veterans of Foreign Wars. Mm-hmm. I'm a member of the American Legion, and I also belong to the AMVETS. For a brief time, I was also a member of the Elks, but I let that go, and
uh-huh.
and I joined the Masons mm-hmm. quite a few years ago, but I haven't been to a Masonic meeting, I think, in 35 years.
And, oh, dear.
You know, it's just, there's only so many things you can do with your
right,
time.
Right, right. And you remain active with these posts?
More so just with the Veterans of Foreign Wars.
Mm-hmm.
I have a position there as a post quartermaster,
mm-hmm.
which is the term for treasurer. And so I pay all the bills. I do the bookkeeping.
Uh-huh. And this is the post up the street?
Yes, it is, right? It's on 135.
Okay. Overall, how important was it for you to serve in the military?
Oh, it was definitely a large part of my life.
Mm-hmm.
It was very important. And I think it was more important to me than it was to my family. I know the... when I retired, I missed it tremendously mm-hmm. at first, and because I was only 49 years old when I retired. So, as a retiree from the National Guard, you don't get a pension until you turn 60.
Mm-hmm.
So when I got my first pension check after my 60th birthday, my wife said to me, she said, "Oh, this is nice." She says, "I really hated it all those years you were in." She says, "But this is nice."
Okay.
This is different.
Mm-hmm. And as far as fellow Vietnam veterans, how do I put it? Do you think the attitude towards Vietnam veterans has changed over the years?
Yes, it has.
Mm-hmm. For the better, I hope?
For the better. Mm-hmm. You know, I have people thank me for my service from wearing my ball cap. Uh-huh. You know, they can see I'm a veteran. And you know, years ago when I first came home, I didn't go out of my way to wear the uniform or to advertise the fact that I was a veteran, because there was there was open hostility back in the late 60s and early to mid 70s until the war in Vietnam concluded, and it was just the veterans were looked down on. I've heard a number of incidents where they were, you know, pointed out and discriminated against.
Right.
I don't know how much of it's true and how much of it's rhetoric, but there was a lot of negativity back in those days, and it was just something we got through.
About veterans of more recent engagements, especially those who are currently fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan.
I thought it was really nice that that these men and women that are serving today are getting the recognition that they should be getting, especially when they came home. And, you know, they had welcoming ceremonies unfortunately, a lot of them have redeployed numerous times. And I know a lot of fellows that wanted to stay in the reserves or the National Guard that simply got out of it because of the multiple deployments.
Right.
And I know people that have been to Afghanistan and Iraq 5 times, you know, in a 6-year period. Mm-hmm. And that's a lot. That's more than some of our fellows did during World War II in Korea. They weren't overseas for that long. They saw some certainly large scale fighting, but a lot of these guys are on just seems like they're rotating from one assignment to the next.
Do you think our nation's Veterans Administration is doing enough to help these veterans, to help Vietnam veterans?
They're doing more.
Yeah.
Than they were a few years back. Well, on a personal level, I have a brother who served in Vietnam after I did, and he's 100% disabled. He has some serious illnesses related to exposure to Agent Orange. Quite frankly, I was exposed to the stuff too. I think I swam in it. I think I swam in a swimming pool that was polluted with it, and while I was over there, and I've been very fortunate. Others have not been so fortunate. And today, you know, my brother is like a lot of other people. He's, you know, he's got serious health problems. And some fellas came down with numerous types of cancers and diabetes and just a litany of health issues. And but the help is there. And so my brother gets a disability, and I know other fellows that are also being helped out with a either a disability pension, or they're getting their medical problems taken care of to one extent or another. And so I think there's been an improvement.
Okay. In 2011, the moving wall came to Natick. Tell us your impressions of that.
Oh, I was thrilled. Absolutely thrilled. I've seen the moving wall, I think, half a dozen times. And I've been to the wall in Washington, D.C. 3 or 4 times. And most recently was last fall when I went down to visit my daughter. And she lives in Alexandria, right outside D.C. And my son-in-law is an arborist, and he works for a company that does a lot of tree work.
and they were hired to do the tree work and the shrubbery for the new Martin Luther King Memorial.
Mm.
And so my son-in-law did quite a bit of that,
mm-hmm.
and came out beautiful. So we went to see the MLK Memorial last fall, and it's really quite impressive to get a chance to go see it. It's a very nice to commemorate Dr. King's life.
Mm.
And it's just across the way from the Vietnam Wall. Mm. It's about a 5-minute walk.
Wow.
And so, you know, I walked over there and I always enjoy seeing the different memorials. I've seen the World War II Memorial, I've seen the Korean Memorial, I've seen the Jefferson Memorial, the Lincoln Memorial.
Mm-hmm.
I've never been inside the Washington Monument because of, I think there were repairs going on one time, and then more recently it was damaged by an earthquake, so
right. It
might be years before that's open again.
Right.
So we'll see.
Okay. Well, Byron, is there anything else you'd like to say before we conclude this interview?
The military was a great part of my life. I loved serving in the military, every bit of it, the good and the bad, and this is a great country we live in. God bless America.
Okay. Well, Byron Prescott, thank you so much for coming in and taking part in the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
My pleasure, Maureen. Okay.